Welcome to Black History Month at UMass Dartmouth. The Black History Month Committee works really hard throughout the entire year to put together programs and events. And seeing you all here today makes it very gratifying. So thank you for coming. All of us, I would like to say, whether we like it or not, Black History begins in January and ends in December every single year. It just so happens that we live in a world that tells us we can only talk about this ongoing reality during the shortest month of the year. So we take the opportunity and we talk about it. And before we really get into it, and our honored guest gives you interesting and very important perspectives, I just want to take a minute to reflect on Black history and to say something very important, that Black history, as you've been taught to view it and practice it, is neither Black nor history. Because you've been taught that Black History Month is a time in which we stop to talk about all of the terrible things that white people have done to Black people. And if you want to be technical about this term history, when you study the actions of white people, when you talk about these actions under slavery, you're technically studying white history. So slavery by itself, as we've been taught to understand it, is not Black history. Black history would be a discussion about what Black people have done, for example, to survive the violence and ensuing legacies of slavery. So Black history, as you've been taught to see it, is not necessarily Black. It's also not history because the ongoing violence lives today. It's practiced on a daily level and witnessed by all of us as we walk through this world. So that when you come to our events and you hear us speak during February and beyond, please understand that when we discuss these things, we're not just talking about Black victims of genocide. We must also bring into the conversation and our consciousness the perpetrators and beneficiaries of this violence, which is why Black history as it's been constructed is neither Black nor history. Does this make sense to people? Thank you. I think that's all I need to say because there's so much more to come, but I am gonna take this opportunity to tell you about who sponsored this event, because we had a lot of campus-wide support that needs to be acknowledged. We were sponsored by the Office of the Provost of Academic Affairs, Office of Equal Employment and Opportunity under Graduate Student Government, Graduate Student Government, Computing and Information Technology Services, the Department of Crime and Justice Studies, and the Black Studies Program. So a lot of people have come together to create this event, and it's always nice to have that sense of community. And I'm grateful for it because we need that if we're gonna get through your education and our jobs in a way that is gratifying and productive and that feels good. So welcome and thank you. And it's my honor to invite our Chancellor, Dr. Davina Grossman, to please come to the stage and introduce our honored guest.
For the next 24 days, our campus and the surrounding community will participate in at least 15 events, 15, designed to teach us and to remind us about a part of our collective history that has in so many ways defined our nation. I wrestle with the idea that we sometimes refer to Black History Month as a celebration. After all, the constellation of events that we have planned for the occasion are not necessarily lighthearted and not always lending themselves to a party experience. Instead, they are more about serious reflection. They are more about recalling a dark period of our history and learning from it. They are about posing hard and serious questions of ourselves and of each other. But then I think maybe this is cause for joy as well, because we live in a place and in a nation where such dialogue is possible and can be a safe place for us to have that dialogue and still be respectful of each other. We should celebrate the advances that we have made as a society, even as we aspire to do more. And so we begin today by welcoming our guest, Dr. Eduardo Bonilla Silva, professor and chair of the Sociology Department at Duke University, and one of the most influential builders of knowledge related to the current state of race in America. Professor Bonilla Silva gained visibility in the social sciences with his 1997 article in American Sociological Review titled "Rethinking Racism Toward a Structural Interpretation." In that article, he challenged social analysts to view racial issues from a structural perspective rather than from a sterile prejudice perspective. Among his most recent contributions to this important dialogue was his appearance on the PBS election special, Race 2012. You probably have seen some of that footage. He is the author or co-author of 5 books since 2002, and I'd like to read those titles so you can get a flavor for the scope and the magnitude and the depth of his work. One is White Supremacy and Racism in the Post-Civil Rights Era. Another is Racism Without Racists, Colorblind Racism and the Persistence of Racial Inequality in the United States. Another is White Out, the Continuing Significance of Racism. Another is White Logic, White Methods, Racism and Social Science. And another is State of White Supremacy, Racism, Governance, and the United States. So I think that gives you a little bit of insight into his work. Dr. Bonilla Silva has received numerous awards, most notably the 2007 Lewis Kosar Award from the Theory Section of the American Sociological Association for Theoretical Agenda Setting. And in 2011, the Cox Johnson Fraser Award, again from the American Sociological Association, and I quote from the award, "to an individual or individuals for their work in the intellectual tradition of the work of these 3 African American scholars." And those are the names in the award, Cox, Johnson, and Fraser. It is truly my pleasure to be here with all of you this morning and to be able to welcome Professor Eduardo Bonilla Silva.
But I was born in Western Pennsylvania. That's the accent from West Pennsylvania. It's February, and I get a cold, 2 colds a year, one in the summer, one in the winter. So today you're going to have to learn about the new America. So a lot of people will sound like me in the future, so this is training. I think that's funny. In 2008, far too many people in this country believed we changed the course of history forever. And it's funny that there are people here. Can someone tell me how many people are in the balcony? No one?
A lot.
A lot? I want to thank all the people in the balcony. This is just amazing. You're listening to someone you cannot see. So imagine that this is like radio. Okay. So in 2008, most people believe we changed the course of history forever. Commentators, analysts, and many social scientists suggested the election of Barack Obama as our 44th president meant we had finally fulfilled Dr. King's dream and become a nation where people, I quote, are not judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. As a scholar of color who looks and sounds like I do, I sincerely wish their claim was true. I wish America had truly become the racial promised land of honey and milk. However, I did not believe this was the case. I argued then, irritating many in the process, that Obama was not a radical visionary in the tradition of Dr. Martin Luther King, but a center-right politician unlikely to rock the foundations of the American political order. I angered liberal whites who, in their wishful thinking, imagined their vote for Obama exonerated them and perhaps their nation of their racial sins. Some of them still have not removed the voted for Obama. Like, you know, Eduardo, I voted for Obama. Like, so what? And I also infuriated many minority folks, blacks in particular, who were experiencing, and still are, a blinding nationalist moment. They wanted me to highlight the racist Tea Party, the Birther movement, the anti-immigration folks in Arizona and elsewhere, the increase in racist organizations and racial violence in the nation, and the Republican Party racist voter suppression efforts in 2012. But doing this, I submit to you, was and still is the easy story to tell. This story of traditional racism did not explain what I think needed explanation. First, why was Obama elected and re-elected? Yeah. And second, what was the racial meaning and implication of his election and re-election? Therefore, today I will continue irritating some folks, as the job of the intellectual is to think hard, examine the evidence, and speak truth to power no matter what, no matter where. Otherwise, we fail as intellectuals and behave like parrots, repeating the racial common sense. I'm doing a Marco Rubio. To make my case, I will do three things. First, describe the character and practices associated with the post-civil rights American racial regime. Second, highlight the racial ideology, the racism or prejudice, if you will, of this order. And lastly, explain how Obama fits this period and make a very controversial argument, so I'm willing to engage in discussions, debates, criticism, etc. at the end. The controversial argument that white supremacy may work better in blackface. Let me begin by asserting some baseline racial facts of our nation. Racial progress in America has stagnated, and worse yet, in some areas we have regressed. 40 plus years after the Kerner Commission report stated, and I quote, that our nation is moving toward two societies, one black, one white, separate and unequal, race still divides the nation in profound ways, and rather than two nations, we may have three or four. Actually, we did have three, four nations before, but that's another story. The evidence for this is clear and convincing. Data on income, wealth, housing, and education and occupational inequality shows huge racial disparities, particularly in blacks and whites, and male Latinos and whites. Studies on discrimination show that it is still a large problem, and more troublesome, they reveal the emergence of a new subtle kind of discrimination that very few analysts or commentators are talking about, and I will have a lot to say about that in my talk today. So how can this be the case? Didn't racism end in the 1960s as Americans became colorblind? The answer is that racism, as a social structure, as a system of practices and mechanisms to maintain systemic white privilege, did not end in the 1960s. Systemic racism morphed into a more sophisticated regime I have labeled the new racism. By this I mean the subtle and apparently beyond race character of most public racial practices. First commercial. They have a kid and he's still, papi, papi, I'm like, get a job. I'm like, dad, the economy is, you know, well systemic. I'm like, come on. He majored in sociology, so he knows how to, you know. Okay. So let me give you a few specific examples of new racism practices. Residential segregation, as I hope many of you in this audience know, was maintained in Jim Crow America through racial terrorism, which still happens today from time to time, less than in the past, but we still have some of that. Through housing covenants, these are agreements in which property owners agreed and signed a contract saying, we will not sell or rent to blacks, Jews, Mexicans, Puerto Ricans, etc. Neighborhood associations, so the South had the Citizens Council, the North had citizens and neighborhood associations that worked effectively to keep folks of color out. And lastly, by the active participation of the federal government, which among other things certified racist lending practices such as redlining, literally having maps of cities and saying, if you live here, you pay more because you are dangerous, yeah? And transferring billions of dollars to whites to create white suburbia. So when we think about suburbs in America today, which are mostly white, this is not a chance event. This is developers in cahoots with our government to create these white bubble spaces, yeah? Okay. Now, all these practices became illegal from 1940 onwards. So no more housing covenants, no more technically discrimination in the housing market because that became illegal. You can get money if you go to a court and claim this person discriminated against me. So therefore, one would expect what? Given that all these things became illegal, residential segregation should be declining in a significant way. And that is not the case. We still are almost as segregated as we were 40 years ago. How can this be the case? The existing segregation in housing is not due to minority folks wanting so-called self-segregation. Have you heard that? Of course you hear in campus, I'm like, look at those black students, they sit in the black table. So whenever someone tells black folks or Latinos that we self-segregate, tell them, what about the white table? I'm like, what do you mean by the white table? I'm like, well, if you see the black table, do you see the white table? No, these are just normal, what do you mean normal? It's a white table. Yeah? And then talk about racial power in the university and why is it that minority folks congregate? Because they feel safer in those spaces and in those conditions. You want integration, you have to do more than just saying, okay, you're in, that's it, yeah? You have to do a lot of work to redistribute racial power. Okay, let me go back to the talk. That came out of nowhere, yeah? Yeah, because I was talking about the argument that you guys are not integrated in housing because you self-segregate, which is not the case. In fact, research shows that we folks of color express a higher preference for living in integrated communities than whites. And that is no surprise. The reason why we say I prefer to live in an integrated community is because of access to resources. So if you ask, so you like it, but Pizza Hut delivers and everybody and the taxi takes me home, etc. So therefore, this integration is not happening because whites use, as I show, new racing practices to maintain residential apartheid. For example, a Harvard team issued a report titled More Than Money and noted that, and I quote, the main reasons for continued segregation include steering by realtors. So this is literally realtors showing people, different neighborhoods, yeah? By the way, illegal. But it's done in a way they're not going to tell you, okay, you're black, so let me show you only these neighborhoods, yeah? They actually refuse to talk about race. Those of us who have been in the housing market in the last 5-10 years know that as soon as you talk about, hey, I want to live in a mixed neighborhood, I'm like, excuse me, I don't talk about race. They are colorblind, yeah? But they have racialized practices, yeah? Such as steering, yeah? Subprime loans, and we learn a lot about these loans. These are bad loans that people of color have received in the last 30 years disproportionately. And they are actually centrally connected to the 2008 collapse. All these banks trying to give extra money from us. The ones who are poorer get even poorer and worse treatment, okay? And lastly, a lack of action by the area's cities and towns. Another report indicated that their testers, so people do test, yeah? So you send whites and whites, I mean whites and non-whites, usually blacks and Latinos, and you match them by all characteristics except phenotype, yeah? And therefore you compare, okay, so you went and what happened to you? So 45 other testers reported experiencing discrimination, and they know because they can compare notes, yeah? And 50% of the black testers. So all testers, Latino and otherwise, experienced discrimination. Blacks got a little bit worse discrimination. The study indicated that the tactic most often used to exclude people was providing differential information. Again, we're in the new racism period. You're not going to be, you have to be clever on how you discriminate. All in all, whites were 5 to 6 times more likely to be told about available units than minority applicants. Let me give you one example. A black tester was advised that the apartments she had just seen were available January 1st. The white tester, December 1st. Advantage white, 1 month. In another case, white tester and Latino tester both emailed an agent about an apartment. The white tester got a reply with pictures of available units. The Latino tester is still waiting for a reply. Is this discrimination? Well, in this case, they know because they have testers. If you as an individual experience this, can you go to a court of law and say, this person didn't reply to my email, therefore? No, you don't have a prima facie discrimination case. So again, the new discrimination is harder to detect and harder to label racial. So the housing and banking practices exemplify new style discrimination because they are hard to detect and even harder to label racial. How can one prove discrimination by banks, realtors, or renters? In the case of banks, one needs access to all the loans approved to show that race matters. By the way, every 10 years, a local, actually in Boston, Boston is one of the worst housing markets in the nation, congratulations. And every 10 years or so, there is a lawsuit, and they force the banks to open their records, and then they find systemic discrimination. So you need either that, or you need a whistleblower inside a bank or a housing development, sort of telling us how white folks are faking the racial fund. Time does not allow to go further, but similar practices have been documented in other venues and areas of life. And I wanted to give you a personal example. So I'm a professor at Duke. Yeah? Duke pays me well. Thank you. I work hard for that. Yeah? Which means that I can go to, you know, Joseph P. Banks or any of these fancy stores and, you know, throw, you know, $300, $400, $500 in a suit. Before I couldn't, but now I can. But of course, I navigate life without a sign saying special black Puerto Rican male works at Duke as the money, please do not discriminate. So when I go to store, I often get the, either they're ignoring me, again, ignoring is prima facie no evidence of discrimination, yeah? So you need to have like a recorder, walk around with a camera to show, yeah? But most often I get the, literally, as soon as I get to the store, may I help you? Just looking. In a minute, may I help you? And the you is like aggressive. No, I'm still looking. And then 2 minutes later, may I help you? I'm like, what? So now I go by the rule of two. First time, may I help you? I'm like, no, just looking. Second time, may I help you? I'm like, yes. I'm trying to steal this fancy coat. And I was wondering if you could provide me some ideas, you know. And the reaction is like, I didn't mean it like that. I'm like, yes, you did. Because if race was not part of the transaction, you should have reacted like, huh? Yeah? I travel across the nation, so often at the end of the talks, some white students who work in stores tells me, we don't do that in our store, but we do this and that and that. And all the strategies have in common this sort of innovative discriminatory style, yeah? And all of them have the issue that imagine I go to a court of law and I sue Joseph P. Bank because someone told me 3 times, may I help you? I look like a fool and I don't get my money, yeah? So Okay. Someone left this here. So let me move on. And by the way, I need to say this. Accordingly, given the character of contemporary discrimination, we people of color must bring along a white friend to go shopping, buy a car, get a loan, rent an apartment, buy a house, drive a car, walk in the streets, or well, to do almost anything in America to prove discrimination. So get your boyfriend. If you don't have anything else, I have a good friend from Vermont. Vermont is like, what, 99% white. And I studied in Wisconsin, so we became really good friends. And we have a contract. So whenever someone calls him racist, he has a, hey, I have a black Puerto Rican friend, so I'm covered. And if someone calls me anti-white, I'm like, hey, some of my great friends are white, and I have evidence. There is a picture of my friend from Vermont. He's a real, original white. That's a joke, folks, relax. I'm under heavy medication because of the cold, so forgive me. So let me now move on to the second leg of my talk, the character of the dominant racial discourse in America. I have addressed this matter in my book, Racing Without Races, where I argue that the nasty racial discourse of the past has been, for the most part, replaced by a more civilized racial discourse that I label colorblind racism. By this I mean the new dominant racial ideology anchored on the extension of the principles of liberalism to race matters in an abstract way. By doing so, this ideology furnishes apparently non-racial explanations to justify racial outcomes. Yeah? So whites can have it both ways. I'm not a racist, but I'm okay with everything that is going on because, as I told you, I'm not a racist. Yeah? Okay, that wasn't too subliminal. But I told you, black and Puerto Rican, I already have two strikes, so I got to be quick. I had to push. The central frames of this ideology are minimization of racism, cultural racism, naturalization, and abstract liberalism. And for time's sake, I will only illustrate one example. The abstract liberal frames, which is the central frame of this ideology. So abstract liberalism incorporates tenets associated with the ideology of liberalism, except that the tenets are used in an abstract and decontextualized manner, which allows whites to oppose everything and look good in the process, okay? And I'll give you one example so you get a flavor of how we talk about race in contemporary America. And the example is Jim, who is a 30-year-old computer salesperson, who explained his opposition to affirmative action in the following way. For the example, ignore his position on affirmative action. That is tangential to the explanation. I want to focus mostly on how he defends his position. I think it's unfair top to bottom on everybody and the whole process. It often, you know, discrimination itself is a bad word, right? But you discriminate every day. You want to buy a beer at the store, and there are six kinds of beers, and you can get from natural light to Sam Adams, right? I'm in the right state to give this talk, yeah? And you look at the price, and you look at the kind of beer, and it's a choice. And a lot of that you have laid out in front of you. Which one you get? Now, should the government sponsor Sam Adams and make it cheaper than natural light because it's brewed by someone in Boston? That doesn't make much sense, right? Why would we want that or make Sam Adams 8 times as expensive because we want people to buy natural light? I use this all the time, precisely because I love the audience being like, huh? So now let's deconstruct what is problematic with this statement. A seemingly race-neutral statement. Strong position, but race-neutral. Yeah? He didn't call me names or anything. Well, so Jim assumes that hiring decisions are like market choices, choosing among competing brands of beer or choosing the so-called best candidate. Yeah. And therefore, he embraces a laissez-faire position. Hire the most qualified person, yeah? Dream on. Research shows clearly that labor market discrimination is alive and well and affects anywhere between 30 to 50% of minority applicants in the job market. Now we have research by a professor at Princeton who just moved to Harvard, Diva Pager, research that I wanted to do 20 years ago, but was not allowed, but she was allowed to do it as a law student. And what she did was, okay, let me check how employers look at resumes. So those of you who are about to graduate, you are writing resumes and send them all over the place, yeah? So she said, okay, let me take the same resume and just change the name. And in one, I'm going to say this is John and this is Tyrone. So you know that most Tyrones in contemporary America are? Hello?
Yeah.
Okay. So that means that if you're an employer and you get that file, Tyrone, no, I don't like Tyrone. But Johnny is good. Mind you, it's the same resume. And she found a significant difference in the likelihood of getting a call back or getting a letter saying, hey, please, we want to see you. So she said, let me go a little bit further. What if I say that Johnny has a criminal record while Tyrone doesn't? And guess what is the finding? Advantage Johnny. That tells you, prima facie, you don't have to go deeper, the significance of race in America. I am all for reincorporation. I'm actually all for abolition of the prison industrial complex like our colleague. But that said, given that that's not going to happen tomorrow, in the meantime, we have to find ways of reintegrating folks with records into our quote-unquote normal society. What I find interesting that given that that is not happening, that in the case of race, you prefer to hire a person with a record than a minority person. Okay, so that's the first issue with his argument. Secondly, he assumes that in America we hire people based on qualifications. That is, that we live in a meritocratic society. Of course, we had George Bush as president for 8 years. After that, you know, we don't have to talk about that too deeply. On the sociological side, again, research shows clearly that we don't live in a meritocratic society and that about 85% of jobs are obtained through networks. So those of you looking for jobs, so yes, get your education. Education matters, but it's not all. Networks matter. So if your colleague is like, what is your last name? Rockefeller. Oh, let's talk, yeah? Because networks matter. Okay. So therefore, by upholding a strict position on laissez-faire economics, Jim can oppose all kinds of things to do the right thing on race and do and look good while doing so. That is what I call this colorblind racism. Yeah? Now, I'm talking about prejudice or an racial ideology. And ideologies are not just about ideas. In order for you to talk about race, besides having these frames that I talk about, you need to have stylistic components that allow you to talk about race at a period in our society where talking about race, particularly mixed company, is dangerous. Let's be honest. Honesty is the beginning of the conversation, yeah? So we know that we don't want to say, hey, you know, I'm against affirmative action. I think it's reverse discrimination, yeah? So if you're a mixed company, you are like, I'm a little bit, not too much, but I have some issues with affirmative action. Not that I'm against, but, you know. So we have all these verbal strategies and pirouettes to talk about race. In the book, I uncover five of these components. The first one is semantic moves, okay? I'm not a racist, but. And after the but, they go crazy, okay? Like the poster for this. I'm not a racist, but. Projection. I cannot believe that Duke hired this black Puerto Rican guy to be the director of a department. That's some kind of reverse discrimination. And I know he feels bad, but I feel quite good. But again, you project motivation onto us. Diminutives, you know. I'm a little bit, tiny little bit against affirmative action, 100% against affirmative action, but just a little bit, yeah. Avoidance of racist talk, so in public venues, we don't use the language we used to use 40, 50 years ago. And lastly, rhetorical incoherence. And that is the example I'm going to give you. I'm going to give you an example of a student. And you know that your generation, well actually young people, you may not know it, but we the oldies know that these young people cannot put a sentence without saying, you know what I mean? No, I don't know, can you like, say it straight, yeah? So when you are doing the analysis, you can look at the transcript and you can differentiate whether the person is incoherent throughout or just in particular questions. In this case, it wasn't a particular question. And the question was to this student called Ray in a certain university in the Midwest, and he was asked, have you ever been attracted to a person of color? When I designed the project, I assumed that the open notion of people of color would be inclusive, so the people could say, well, I had this half Vietnamese, half white girlfriend, so yeah, I'm covered, yeah? And actually, one of the respondents said, do Italians count? Says a lot about the hierarchy among the people we call white, yeah? For Ray, people of color was black people. So therefore, this was his answer. So to answer that question, no. But I would not ever preclude a black woman from being my girlfriend on the basis that she was black. You know what I mean. If you're looking about it from, you know, the standpoint of just attraction, I think all women have a sort of different type of beauty, if you will. And I think that, you know, for black women, it's somewhat different than white women. But I don't think it's, you know, I mean, it's nothing that would ever stop me from, like, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't, if that's, I mean, that just sort of be my impression. I mean, it's not like I would ever say no. I never have a black girlfriend. But it just seems to me like I'm not as attracted to black women as I am to white women for whatever reason. It's not about prejudice. It's just sort of like, you know, whatever, just sort of the way, like, I see white women as compared to black women, you know? I think I don't need to explain this case. But I have to tell you that I race match. White people interviewed whites. Blacks interviewed the blacks in my sample. And this young white woman, who was not a sociology major, so I trained them, very aggressive. And she learned. And one of the first things you learn when you do interviews is you have to pay attention to what they're saying, yeah? So you have your script of the questions, but you have to pay attention first because you value the time of the people, yeah? And it is your responsibility. If you don't understand, so when this guy finished with the, you know what I mean? And she's like, no, I don't. Do you care to elaborate? So in the book, you can get the follow-up where he got even worse trying to explain, yeah? The last component of colorblind racism is what I call racial stories, and I divide them into three categories. And since I want to move on, I'm going to only give you an example of testimonies, which are these personal accounts, and all of us have heard them, yeah? I know for a fact that Johnny was not admitted to Harvard because a black guy got it, and I know this for a fact because my cousin heard that someone told them that he heard, yeah? So that's the kind of stories, okay. So here is a respondent called, what's his name? A retired school teacher, Bill, I call him. So obviously I changed the names of all the respondents. Who narrated the following story. So he claims that black people are different. And his explanation or justification is his testimony, where he says that black people are very religious people, but they moved into his neighborhood and took down a restaurant, okay? So this is his explanation. They like to eat. They piled their dishes just loaded with that stuff, and I actually didn't see it, but I saw one lady come in with a full plate of chicken. I didn't pay much attention. But the next thing I know, they're leaving. Now, I know she didn't eat all that chicken. She probably put it in her purse and walked out with it. A lot of them are doing that. How can they make any money? And seeing that they're all heavy people, it seems like they do a lot of eating. So I don't know what to say about something like that. Okay, so this is an older respondent transitioning. It can be one of our grandparents, yeah? Transitioning from Jim Crow ideology to the colorblind mantra. Not doing too well in the transition. But I wanted to give you the flavor of people at different stages and in different, you know, not only college students or regular folks out there, but he's a retired person, yeah? Okay, so now let me talk about the part that will be most controversial in my talk, which is I claim that the election and now re-election of Barack Obama as president did not derail in a meaningful way the direction of America's racial order. In the last two elections, we did not see what was in front of our noses. We saw what we wanted and longed to see. Whereas blacks and other minorities saw in Obama the impossible dream come true, whites saw confirmation of their belief that America is indeed a colorblind nation. So we all remember that night, November 4, 2008. And yes, I did cry, and they immediately wiped my tear. I said, the struggle continues, yeah? We were like all looking for someone to hug, you know, emotional. But there is a more fitting, historically accurate, and sociologically viable explanation for Obama's so-called miracle. One, I advanced 6 months before he was elected. Lost a lot of friends by not endorsing publicly Obama. And I couldn't because I did what most of us, let's be honest, how many of us knew a lot about Obama before the election? And the answer is, let's be honest. Okay. So I did reading, and I checked his positions on things that were of importance to me, race, Palestine, my wife is Palestinian, so I wanted to know what was his position on Palestine, etc. And based on that, I've been asked to co-chair the Black Progressive Sociologists for Obama. I said, my brother, I cannot co-chair this. I may end up voting for him, but I will do so critically, saying, I'll vote for him, but I would love Obama to do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And let's be honest, we didn't do that. We gave him a blank check in 2008. And although we were concerned 212, we gave him another blank check. And I don't give blank checks to no one. Okay. So my explanation was that the fact that race matters in America in every aspect of our lives, yet we elected the black man as our president is but an apparent contradiction. Obama, his campaign and success are the outcome of 40 years of racial transition from the Jim Crow order to the regime I have referred today as the new racism, or the new face of white supremacy. In Obamerica, a term I coined, so don't use it. In Obamerica, Obama elected president without the backing of a social movement, so he's a different kind of black politician, you know, not connection to social movements. Racism has remained firmly in place, and even worse, is becoming a more formidable obstacle as Obama's so-called post-racial stand and persona bolster the racial order. Therefore, my big point in the next few minutes is that Obama does not represent change we can believe in, as he said in 2008, but more of the same in the racial terrain. Hello? I'm alone here? No one agrees with me? Okay. So what is Obama's connection to the new racism? An important component of the post-civil rights racial order is the process of selecting and vetting minority candidates, a process developed by the Republican Party. That's not a mistake. I'm making the argument that the Republicans and the Democrats are different, but not as much as we believe. They are both ultimately representatives of corporate America, who pays, who ends up running in both parties. Okay. After the Democratic Party co-opted many old civil rights leaders like John Lewis, Andrew Young, and the like, and made them shadows of themselves, both parties forged a new kind of minority politician. Today's minority politician is electorally oriented, is not the product of social movements, joins the party of choice while in college, and moves quickly through the party ranks. The new minority politicians, unlike their predecessors, are not radicals talking about the revolution and uprooting systemic racism and black power. If Republican, they are anti-minority conservatives such as Bobby Jindal, Susana Martinez, or Nikki Haley. These are governors, one Indian, the other one is Latina, and Nikki Haley is American Indian. And if Democrats, they are post-racial leaders with center-to-center-right policies such as Harold Ford, former congressman for Tennessee, now MSNBC commentator. Some of you, Morning Joe, yeah. I'm not the only, Morning Joe, yeah?
I don't know.
Okay, okay. But you knew it was
okay.
I see him on TV all the time, yeah. Folks, on top, you cannot see, I'm taking a sip of water. You have to keep folks, you know, involved. Yeah? Okay, so Harold Ford, Cory Booker, mayor of Newark, former mayor of Newark, now the senator, yeah? Adrian Fenty, and of course, Barack Obama. Not surprisingly, plutocrats, rich folks, love these minority politicians because whether Republican or Democrat, neither threatens the power structure of America. Obama's case is illustrative. By 1987, remember the campaign he kept telling us, I'm a community organizer? Actually, he did 2 years of paid community work. Those of us who have been in real social movements know that usually you don't get paid for doing community work. He did get paid. At the time, again, older folks, you remember what I'm talking about. Remember that Chicago had the black mayor, and it was a coalition of Latinos, blacks, and liberal whites that elected Harold Washington. At the time, Obama was very critical of Harold Washington. After 2 years of doing community work, he discovered that any of us doing community work and social movement type of work, no. It is very hard work, and you don't see change like in 2 seconds, yeah? It may take years for you to accomplish precious little. And he decided to get off the community work, go to Harvard, get his degree, and then he said, you know, he used to be critical of Harold Washington. Again, young people read about Harold Washington, very progressive black mayor. And Chicago is an example of you can have a city that is minority, and still have white folks running the show. And in part it was because of what happened after Harold Washington died. At any rate, so he was critical of Washington, and then he became like, I want to do one better. I may become a senator, and who knows, maybe I become the first black president. Yeah? To run for president, you have to have a big ego. I mean, this is everybody. Yeah? So Obama had, and still has, a big ego. That's part of the thing of being a so-called leader. Yeah, you have to believe in yourself. Now, in 2004, I think, he gave that speech in the convention. I don't see a black America and a white America. I only see the United States of America and the audience with me, you know, which is like, my brother, now that you're president, you need to do an eye examination. And it's for free because it's like, you know, you have a good healthcare plan in the White House. But that nationalist statement, that actual argument about we are all one, I don't see race, push him to the top, yeah? But the question is, why in 2004, if you didn't know him in 2008, why was he given the platform in 2004? Easy, because he had met the rich hunches in the Democratic Party in the house of Vernon Jordan. Again, older folks remember Vernon Jordan, formerly a member of the civil rights movement, who then became a millionaire. Okay, so that part some of you may not know. He sits in 20 or so corporate boards. They need one black guy. And they say, okay, you're going to be our diversity, so we're going to give you $50,000 a year for going to 3 meetings. I'm like, and we're going to meet in Hawaii. I'm like, hey, I'm in for that. Yeah. Okay. So he met with all these rich folks, and they love him. And they claim the following 3 things. We love him because he's not a racial polarizer. Not Jesse Jackson. Secondly, because he's not anti-business. And lastly, they love that he had a swag Harvard star, which an argument that came back into it when politicians in both parties said, well, Obama is so articulate, so we're not allowed to be articulate, because we're supposed to be like, yeah, massa, I don't know English yet. Here. So what did Obama do? So what did Obama do to get elected? First, he worked with the mainstream of the Democratic Party, raised money the same way And this, again, don't trust anyone, even me. Check this online. Center for is it Corporate Responsibility or something like that. So you have, you can get data on who is giving money to what. You can even go by colleges, even by people, and know who is giving money to what party and to what candidate. So in 2008, Obama raised more money from Wall Street than McCain. And presumably the Republican Party represents rich people. Well, not in 2008. Why? Because McCain crazy, yeah? And he, to his credit, during the meltdown, he started calling bankers, and now we have books coming out saying, yeah, I was in the office. He cursed this banker, yeah? How you dare do this, you know, you... Mo-. So, therefore, the Wall Street types didn't trust McCain. They're like, I don't know what he's going to do. Obama is suave, and you know, he's a little bit like, you know, social democratic, but I think I can trust this guy. So they put their money on Obama in 2008. They switched in 2012 because they had a member of their class running for the presidency. Yeah? So they are very sort of active in deciding, in this election, this is our best candidate. In this one, someone else. Okay. And lastly, Obama organized a messianic campaign that joined actors from different venues of life who congealed into this campaign of 2008, not knowing what the heck was going on. And for those of us on the left of things, we were sort of putting a corner. Yeah, and the corner was, so what are you going to do? Vote for the fascist? And the term fascist has been used too lightly in America in the last 40 years, yeah, since Ronald Reagan, yeah? And those of us who remember social movement politics are in this corner because every 4 years, same thing. Are you going to vote for the Republican guy or for Billy Clinton or for Al Gore or for Obama? The lesser of two evils, which means you are still voting for evil, okay? I'm going to give you at the end an alternative to this seemingly impossible political situation, okay? So second, the policies Obama endorsed during the campaign, which he has continued endorsing and enacting as president, were not truly radical and likely to accomplish that empty slogan of change, yeah? I want change, and everybody wants change. Okay, Obama had seriously problematic stance on healthcare, jobs, the housing meltdown, the financial crisis, and on immigration. So today, the Obama administration is deporting about 400,000 people a year, which is more than George Bush during his administration. And lastly, he has a mess in terms of foreign policy in Iraq, which is now, you know, the media stopped reporting, but Iraq is as bad as it was 5-6 years ago. Okay. Third, Obama reached the level of success he did in large measure because he made a strategic, not tactical, strategic move towards racelessness and adopted a post-racial persona and political stance. He distanced himself from most leaders of the civil rights movement, so Jesse Jackson is gone, yeah, you don't see him anywhere, from his own good and now much maligned Reverend Wright. And when that controversy transpired, because he dared to say racism is endemic to America. He's right, Reverend Wright was right. Racism is endemic to America. And by just doing this and covering our eyes, we don't stop that fact from being part of our reality. Okay, so, and also he distanced himself from anything or anyone who made him look too black or too political. Even in 2008, the campaign removed his wife, Michelle Obama, for a month, remember? When she was too radical, too Angela Davis, and they took her out, changed her hairstyle, reintroduced her in that show, The View. Yeah, softy kind of show. And then they were all into like, where do you buy your clothes? J. Crew, oh my goodness, you are like a black woman, but you are like us, but black, and we love you, yeah? I'm going to say this, always get in trouble, but it's the truth. I happen to believe that Michelle Obama is a more capable person than Barack Obama. I have seen her. giving speeches top of her head, whereas Obama has a teleprompter. As someone who does this for part of my career, I wish I had the teleprompter. That would be good, yeah? I'm talking to you, I'm just reading stuff here. And Michelle has been reduced now to playing hula hula and growing tomatoes in the White House. And before some of you, in the black folks in the audience, particularly black women, get mad with me, I remind you two things. I said that I think she's more capable. And secondly, let's be honest. Would we supported Obama to the level that we have done, at the 95% plus level, if he was married to a white woman? Be honest. Okay. Anyway, and when he talked about race in that infamous Philadelphia speech, or the more recently in 2013 in that speech in Morehouse College, he talked about race in the wrong way. He basically talked about race like most white people talk. The problem is prejudice. And therefore, in the Philadelphia speech, what he did was, I see racism in the black community, I see racism in the white community, everybody can be racist. For those of us who do this for research and for work, we know that racism has to be analyzed fundamentally as a matter of differences in power. So everybody can be prejudiced, yeah? But not everybody has the power to create a system that systematically benefits some and disadvantages others. That's another business altogether. And secondly, in that speech in Morehouse, and black folks, when are we going to smack Obama, and sometimes Michelle, for putting us down? If you read the transcript without knowing that it's Obama talking, you would be like, man, and like, this guy's saying that the problem with black men is that they don't work hard, that they have baggy pants, that they watch too much TV, and this and that. But somehow, part of the nationalist moment is that we're giving a pass to Obama and Michelle on everything. They can tell us everything. We are like, well, got to support them. They are black. That's it. And I remind all the folks in the audience, we did this 20 plus years ago during the confirmation hearings of, that's right, Clarence Thomas. And the NAACP took forever to come out and say we opposed them. And it took them forever because they had this sort of nationalist blind spot in which they are like, he black, when he's in the Supreme Court, he'll switch. How is that working for you? Okay. Obama has continued his post-racial stand-up persona as president when asked in press conferences, which used to happen way back. Now nobody asks him about race, yeah? Now he's clear. I don't want to talk about race. So the first time he was asked by a journalist from the Chicago Tribune, his answer was, I hear you. When someone tells you, I hear you, you know what it means? They are not hearing you. Yeah? I hear you. But we're dealing with deep problems in America and two wars, therefore. So basically, he told the nation, race and racism are not central problems in the nation, which is wrong. Racism is part of the nation and is one of the central obstacles for us to move forward. And in that infamous Gates incident, all of you remember, because it happened just around here in Harvard, what did Obama do? First, he said the police acted stupidly. Interesting comment. I think acted in a predictable manner. Yeah? So criminal justice scholars know that racial profiling is as American as apple pie. So the police did what they do to all of us. Yeah. 2 days later, he changed. He said, well, I should have calibrated my words better. And by the end of the week, he's saying we should have a beer summit. My fellow Americans, if the problem of raising America could be settled by drinking beer, we would have no problem. Because in the beer consumption business, we're doing quite well. Thank you. Okay. Obama has continued his post-racial stand and persona as president. Oh, I already mentioned that. So how have my predictions on Obama fared now that he has been president for what, five years, yeah? Overall, I'm on the money. I thought that was clever. Apparently, only I think it's clever. So Obama has followed US imperial policies in Iraq, Iran, Pakistan, and Afghanistan, as well as in Latin America, And after a brief period of reversing Bush's so-called counter-terrorist policies, remember he told us, I'm going to close Guantanamo, it's bad business, etc. He basically is doing the same thing and has not closed Guantanamo, still doing renditions, and has increased exponentially drone attacks. Let me get off script. Mark my words. We're going to suffer from these drone attacks big time in the next 15, 20 years. The part that we, the people, are not getting is that most often, these drone attacks end up not killing the so-called terrorists we're after. We kill a lot of innocent people. And then we think, like, yeah, but, you know, since we are justified by what we're doing, people will understand. I'm like, really? You kill innocent people? I'm like, I understand. You were not trying to kill me. You were trying to kill the other guy. I hear you. On the domestic front, his stimulus package did not target workers and folks of color. It has been, for the most part, a failure. His healthcare reform did not deal with the central issue at hand, which is, and still is, controlling costs and trying to make the system universal or close to it. The financial reform he passed had some good things, but at the end of the day, he didn't do what he needed to do, which is control these banks. Yeah? Do you know that banks today are bigger? Remember, too big to fail? And remember, we're promised we're going to do a real reform. Guess what? Banks today are bigger than they were in 2 weeks. So what are we going to do when they go again and like, hey, I need some of your money because this stuff is collapsing? If they were too big to fail in 2008 and they're bigger today, I predict, it's a deep sociological observation, that we're going to bail them again and again and again. Lastly, on the race front, Obama has done very little. His cabinet is whiter than Bush's. I'm not saying that having black or Latino people guarantees anything, but that is an indicator of, you know, where you, I mean, you want to signify, yeah? And if you are only surrounded by white folks, that signifies something, yeah? Obama has avoided talking about race. Do we agree on that? Yeah, he has avoided talking about race. I talked about the Skip Gates controversy. Some of you remember the Shirley Sherrod case, that's the black woman who was fired for supposedly saying something she did not say. And Obama, through the Secretary of Agriculture, fired her because he was concerned about what Glenn Beck would say in his show. If you're concerned about Glenn Beck, you're in trouble. Remember Glenn Beck? Yeah? Glenn Fox? Come on, some of you watch, okay. Don't lie to me, I know you watch Fox, okay. And in the Trayvon Martin case, I think he failed, ultimately, to talk about what he should have talked. I was moved somewhat when he said it could have been my son. It could have been my son too. Had I been president, and I told you I was born in the US, so I qualify. Get ready for prime time, America. I would have said, my fellow Americans, the issue here is racial profiling, which is connected to a system of white supremacy that we have not been able to uproot. So let's begin the conversation there, yeah? Let's begin the conversation on racial profiling as an outgrowth of this white supremacy order we have. And yeah, I would have been ousted of the White House, but you know, what the hell, I have been ousted of better places. And we Latinos should be mad as hell as Obama. Latinos in the audience? Hello? No one? Any Puerto Rican? Viva Puerto Rico, yeah. So we are responsible for his victory. In 2008, only 3 states counted. You know how the elections work here. It's not the vote, it's each state gets. Okay, so only 3 states counted, New Mexico, Colorado, and Nevada. And we were responsible for his victory in these 3 states. And Obama promised us what? I'm going to do immigration reform. And now what? No immigration reform. They keep postponing. But a little bit, he left Marco Rubio. So let me let the Latino guy. I don't count Marco Rubio as my brother, okay? So he left Marco Rubio in charge. And now, he has sort of moved back and is letting, what's his name? The fellow in charge of Congress, Republican, sort of do the honors in this reform, which means that the reform is going to go to the right. And it's going to be an anti-minority immigration reform. So accordingly, we have a black president who, like inexpensive chocolate ice cream, delivers the color, but not the all-important flavor. Let me conclude by first giving you the big take-home points of my talk. First, racism forms a structure or a system of practices that I claim has shifted from the Jim Crow regime to the new racism. I think we, both as analysts, as intellectuals, but as people who navigate the country, we need to get on with this reality. The more we keep talking about Jim Crow, the more we fail to see what is happening in the nation. Yeah? Secondly, I claim that there is a new smiley sidekick monster, yeah? Colorblind racism. So this new system has an accompanying ideology. So that doesn't mean that we don't fight the fools who use the racist language of the past. We got to be ready for prime time. But we also have to identify that there is a new way of talking about race, which actually is more dangerous and is becoming the dominant way used by whites to talk about race in America. And lastly, I claim that Obama doesn't represent change we can believe in, but more of the same, and actually perhaps the highest stage of this new racism order. So what is to be done to slay the new racial dragon terrorizing the American castle? If we wish to slay this monster for real, we must get back to the fierce urgency of now that Dr. King talked about and return to social movement politics. That's the part of politics that we don't get. The more you get into vote for this or vote for that, you miss that politics is much larger, much bigger than just electoral politics. By the way, I'm not telling you not to vote, but be strategic. And if you're going to vote, ask your candidate what all interest groups do in America. If you want my support, I want A, B, C, and D. And that's what we should do with Obama or with Hillary or whoever you want to support. But at the same time, know that historically we have gotten more out of social movement politics on the race, class, and gender front, that's through electoral politics. That's what the historical record shows. You want change, you want deep change, you organize. You push for social change through social movement politics. If we remain stuck in the stupid political gear, and we have been in this gear since 1980 with the election of Ronald Reagan, we will continue seeing fascism in the corner and voting for any dummy the donkeycrats nominate for president. If we want change we can truly believe in, we, the people, must make our own history. We must be in the streets, mobilized, organized, and militant once again. But we must also be creative. So now let me talk to the old heads in the room. So we remember the way we did it. And the new generation is doing stuff that, like, I don't understand this hip hop, you know. And I saw the Super Bowl, and that guy, I don't know what he's doing. And you should know, because what he's doing is a lot of the stuff. You know. Anyway, what's his name? He has some Puerto Rican in the room. He has some Puerto Rican background, you know that? Okay. Anyway, so we must be creative and use innovative social movement tactics. For my money, the Michael Moore type of political intervention, of using humor, but also sort of in your face. Here, you claim that you are colorblind, but everyone in the office is white. Explain that to me. Put the microphone, yeah? So we can use this kind of strategies to show and expose not only that race matters, but how it matters. I end with a quote from the most maligned and still fundamental Malcolm X. Nobody can give you freedom. Nobody can give you equality or justice or anything. If you are a man or a woman, you take it. Yeah, we have to update. Yeah? This is the kind of, by the way, this was viewed as anti-white, whatever. I'm like, he's talking about if no one wants to treat you as an equal member of society, you have the right of fighting for your place. Yeah. This is the kind of spirit I hope people of color and their progressive allies embrace if they wish to get out of the morass we find ourselves at this point. Yeah. If we keep putting all of our eggs in the electoral political basket, we will end up like the Cheshire Cat in Alice in Wonderland. A fading smile hanging alone in the tree we call America. Thank you.
The comment I have is, given that we live in a society and a culture that the systems that we have and the culture we have develop in a climate of racism, it's impossible to think that we are not, just like we're affected by our environment, the chemicals in our air come into our body, we are inherently infected with racism. And I think that the coded language of the day is kind of interesting too, like in terms of like, when you talk about racism, like there's words that I'm seeing more and more often used, like urban or different things. What is your take on the fact that the struggle to root out racism internally for all folks, how does that play into this in terms of getting it debunked?
Yeah, that's a good question. And obviously, all systems of domination are hard to undo, uproot, and challenge. But you know what? The Roman Empire collapsed. Slavery ended. And although the history books will tell you Lincoln didn't free no. Okay? Lincoln actually believed in continuing. He was a white supremacist member of white America. Like, oh, I mean, read the debate with Douglas, where he said that, I believe that the position of superiority in America should be given to whites compared to blacks, yeah? So we were central. So think about the huge participation of blacks in the Civil War. And we forced a change from that slavery regime to Jim Crow. And Jim Crow wasn't our salvation, but it gave us some space. And Jim Crow ended, no matter how much people tell you it was, like, you know, it was because of the goody of white folks in the North, who were like, you know, oh my goodness, look at this Southern people, what they do to black. And I'm like, similar to what you do to black in the North. Don't fake it, man, we know you. So the civil rights movement was central to that change. Between 1960 and 1970, 250 so-called race riots forced a change in the nation. So the ruling white corporate elite decided we need to change this game, because if the house is burning, we cannot make money. And the color they like the most after white is green. So they all started putting, four foundations started putting money on Black History Month, and black this and black that. Then we give them like a one professor of color per department, and that way they get their diversity. And you know, they want. So anyway, so I put my faith not in the goodness of people, but in social movement. And through social movement, I'll tell you this, not only you change, but you force a massive change in what you call the culture of society. So older folks in the room remember the 60s and 70s, and if you participate in a social movement, it will change you for life. It will also change people around. So what was normative in the 60s became not acceptable in the 70s. Now let me be pessimistic. So that's the good part. The pessimistic in me is that change is hard. I think that the US is slowly becoming like Latin America. Colorblindness is not new in the world. You guys, for you, it's new. For us, in Puerto Rico, Mexico, Brazil, we have been doing the colorblind nonsense for 100 years. And the problem with that is that the more we allow this ideology and this system to gel, to solidify, the harder it will be for us to fight. It could begin with things such as, you know, since we're colorblind, we don't need data on race because we're all American. So let's stop collecting data on prisons, let's stop collecting data on the census. We're all Americans, like Puerto Rico did for 60 years, yeah? So that's the pessimistic person in me. I always have to put my focus on social movement activity. That is the possibility. That is the space for salvation, if you allow me to use a real language, in the mess we're in. So thank you for your question.
I'm especially interested in education policy. And from a lot of texts that I've analyzed, the social studies books of a lot of students trouble me, and they tend to, you know, glorify like white past, if you will, minimalize the action, the evil actions of previous presidents, you know, glorify everything white. And I can't even imagine what it must be like to not be white and to be in one of those classrooms and to have to learn and see people that don't look like you and to not, you know, to just feel so excluded and, you know, to not be able to have your history appreciated. Do you see any sort of policy solution that could address the quite racist and also sexist and religionist, I mean, really quite any, if you're not white, Protestant, and male, you know, do you see any sort of policy solutions for that?
For books in schools? Yeah. For books in schools?
For curriculum in general, especially social studies.
That applies also to colleges, yes. So we have all these courses on, you know, art history, and it is Western art. So they cover 10% of humanity, and that is called art history. So again, I'm going to sound like a broken record. All these things are connected to social movements. If you want curricular reform at the level of high schools, etc., you got to get elected, and you got to begin raising this as an issue. We have failed collectively, folks of color, and our allies, for 30 plus years, because we have put all of our political energy in supporting the Democratic Party. And all our issues are diluted. So we may bring it to a, you know, I'm a member of this group, okay, you know what, I'm concerned that in my school they are just teaching this white supremacy history, and I want to change that. Like, but don't you think that we need to prioritize, and it's more important in small cities, let's talk about development and making sure that they have a minority person in the development stuff. And I'm like, no, I want change here. Because all this is called, I also want the money, yeah? So I want the development, and I want to make sure that folks of color are included in the process. But I also want this. So what we need to do then is, if this is an issue, and it is, we need to begin raising it. And we have to begin raising it at the local level, yeah? So remember that in this country, we don't have a federal system of education, yeah? So you have to go by localities. I live in Texas for 8 years, and in Texas, you know, they are the most reactionary textbooks, yeah? Where they don't want to teach real history. They want to teach white supremacy history without any kind of cover, yeah? So the answer then is we need to organize, and we need to begin asking. One of the problems that we're having is that we're not even asking what we want, yeah? So we're like, oh, this is racist. Like, be specific. I want this, I want that, yeah? For example, I stopped asking for civil rights. That's not the issue. I want equality. And let's talk about how we get equality. I want equality of outcomes. I'm like, that's some kind of racism. I'm like, no. If you claim we're colorblind, we should expect that in all the good and bad things in society, we should be represented more or less proportionally. So we shouldn't be 3 times as likely to be incarcerated. And we should not be like, you know, 90% less likely to be a college professor. Again, if you believe the mythology of colorblindness, show me the money. Show me empirically that you live in a colorblind society. But if you're just faking the funk and telling me we're colorblind but everything is color-coded, come on, send that to someone else, not to me.
Hi, hello. My question is, I agree with you that Barack Obama came like he was going to be a game changer, and nobody held him accountable in 08 or this past election last year. My question is, in 2016, do you see the same exact thing happening with Hillary Clinton? People say, oh, is she supposed to be the change? Or is she, like, she seems like she's pretty identified as the establishment person. She'll continue, whoever the Democratic nomination ends up being, Republican, same thing. I feel like the same policies are gonna persist too. So I feel like, I also agree that it, because I'm so pessimistic about politicians doing it with Democrat and Republican, they're all the same. I agree with that issue. I think it's almost like, you see like the Arab Spring over there, it's like, I see people in Egypt, 1 million people in the streets, and you can't do that in America, you know what I mean? So I'm kind of like embarrassed when I see all the stuff that happens in this country that we can't get people to stand up and do that. But
We did a little bit when during the Occupy movement, yeah, so we did a little bit.
A little bit, absolutely. But so my question is, what do we do as a response, like with the, whoever the mainstream political process, they get handpicked, like you said, like it's a dualistic fallacy to think, oh, one or the other, you know what I mean? That eliminates 350 million people from being president, you know, it's down to two people. So I just feel like we should delegitimize that whole process and say both of these people are crooks, you know what I mean? And like have no, I wouldn't vote for either one of those candidates. Just so we can say
Martin Luther King and Malcolm X were not elected politicians, and I humbly submit to you that they were more relevant for changing America than Barack Obama and all these black and Latino and a few Asian leaders in Congress and in states. So again, going back to my answer, you know, I'm making money easy, telling them social movements. So that's number one. That said, let's go back to the beginning of your question. What do I think will happen in 2016? Given that the social movement that we're talking about probably will not be in place by 2016, we are going to be collectively back to the same corner. On one party, we're going to have a ruthless person, because, you know, imagine how the situation of the Republican Party, where their best candidate was the governor of New Jersey, this crook, you know. And now they're going to go farther right, most likely, yeah? And then the Democratic Party is going to give you the hierarchical, you know, imperial answer, Hillary Clinton, who has been elected to everything. Like, okay, now is the time for a woman. Say, yeah, for a white woman that has money and has been connected to politics forever. So our job is, if, as I predict, we're not going to have a strong social movement in place, and the Democratic Party depends on us to get elected. Let's be honest. Check the data. Democrats are getting like 41% of the white vote. Okay? They need black and Latinos to vote at the 70, for Latinos 70%, for blacks 90% for the party. And they need us happy. So it's not enough for us just to vote. We have to be enthusiastic, which means we have to show up, yeah? Who cares if you, 80% of blacks voted, but only two of them voted, yeah? Okay, so what we need to do is, the civil rights organizations and the new organizations that should be emerging, we should make demands. At this point, we're not going to change the entire social order, but we can ask for specific things. We want prison reform. So we're not going to get abolition now, but we can demand prison reform. And we want, prison abolition. It won't happen. So we may ask for prison abolition, and that's the nature of social politics. You ask for the moon, and get something else. So maybe after all, we need to ask for prison abolition, and they tell us, okay, we're going to make sure that rather than black people being overrepresented as they are, that they are proportionally represented. Yeah? And in terms of jobs, we need real jobs for America, yeah? So all this, unemployment is going down a little bit because people stop looking for jobs. That's what happened in the last report, yeah? Unemployment went down because we're not even going to look for a job. And when you get a job, it's like a joke. It's easy to get two jobs in America, yeah? So everybody needs two jobs to survive. So what we need is then to ask for meaningful jobs. We're having a debate. I mean, how can we have a debate about raising the minimum wage? I mean, this should not be a debate. And many of us, folks of color, end up in those jobs. So a demand for fair wages, yeah, for a living wage, should be central to the next election, yeah? I don't think it's going to happen under the Obama administration. So for us, is if you want my vote, I want A, B, C, D, and E. And if not, I stay home talking to my best friend, Dr. Johnny Walker Black. He is my best friend. He talks back to me. Green is probably better, smoother. There was a question here.
Hi, thank you for taking my question. So one part of your lecture that really interested me was when you were talking about discrimination with the beers, do you think that this kind of idealism of this laissez-faire, you know, way of making choices, like promoting efficiency over equity, do you think that kind of ideology perpetuates, you know, discrimination, racism, in a way that doesn't just go beyond like that metaphor that, you know, it's more profitable to have, you know, a white male, you know, main actor in a movie. You know, that's who's gonna, they're gonna have that privilege, that choice, that preference immediately to them. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I just think it's so interesting how that kind of ideology, because the ideology is also so prevalent in our society that...
And at least in the short term, we're in a corner, yeah? Because they don't need to use the language of the past. They look good. They can make a pro-capitalist argument, yeah? So think about the movie 21. Some of you remember that movie a few years ago, yeah? 21 was this movie about these kids, MIT kids, that go to Vegas and make a lot of money. So the main characters were these two, a white girl, white fellow, and the sidekicks were all Asians. The real story was that all the kids were Asian kids working for the white professor, and the movie producers decided these people, the audience will not relate to them because, you know, I'm like, no, I don't know. Can you explain? Well, you know, we love Asian kids, but you know. I'm like, no, I don't know. Can you explain? So basically it was a white supremacy argument. And I'm willing to engage in that discussion about money, yeah? If you put people of color, you don't make money. Okay, let's have that discussion. And what does that mean about the society? You cannot claim to be colorblind and at the same time have this kind of racial explanation. It makes no sense, yeah? So, but in the short term, they look good in making the arguments because the beauty of colorblindness is precisely that. You can talk about race without talking about race. You can talk about urban people, though, you know, I want to work with urban people. Urban people are problematic, and I love urban people, but I would never live in with urban people, yeah? And everybody knows what we're talking about. Yet, you always have plausible deniability. So our job is to understand what's going on, educate ourselves about how people talk so that we can be ready for prime time in ideological battles, yeah? All systems change, yeah? So one can claim that the fight against slavery and Jim Crow, as our brother suggested, was easier because things were clear. Tell that to the enslaved Africans fighting against slavery and tell them, yeah, you guys are easy because it was so in your face that you can fight, and like, in your face. Someone owned me, man. It wasn't easy. And the struggle against Jim Crow wasn't a picnic, yeah? So although we now, from 40 years, 50 years forward, we can look back and say, oh, because of this violence, it was easier to organize compared to today. I don't think that actually is the way that we should be framing things. The job for you and my brother is the same. Analyze the monster you have in front of you and begin developing ideas and strategies to fight back. Now, what we're doing, which is nothing, I can guarantee you this, if we keep doing what we're doing, which is nothing, then the monster will eat us up, and then we'll be all unhappy forever. Okay, next question. By the way, I hope there is some food in the Unity House, because I'm hungry, you know.
We like to eat.
Yeah, I need to be straight, you know. This talking is good, but I want some food, you know. Hopefully some Puerto Rican food. Some mofongo, some like, you know. Hello.
Hi, Professor. I just want to question what exactly is prison reform for you, because I don't know if you could really reform a prison if you think about the overall structure of what a prison is.
Are you taking a class with her?
I sat in most of her classes, yes.
The answer is, I'll give you the progressive answer and then the liberal answer. The progressive answer is I'm 100% with the notion of let's abolish the prison industrial complex. Doing that requires a revolution of everything, yeah? Because the prison industrial complex is not out there an independent fact. It's connected to the social order. I hope that you and I are honest enough to admit that that will not happen tomorrow. So the issue for us is, if you are dying of hunger, and this is going to sound stupid, but that, I'm willing to be stupid collecting. So feel this. So if you're hungry and you want bread, and someone gives you just the crumbs, are you going to say, I don't want no crumbs, I want the real loaf of bread, or I prefer to die? I submit to you that historically most of us have taken the crumbs, but not because we're happy. So if we get a little reform that we know is not going to change the system, I'm not going to be happy. I take that, but I don't stop the fight. Taking a reform doesn't mean that's it. It means I got something, I can show something to the people, because the people are not going to be behind you if you only tell them, give me life or give me death. And like, is there anything in between? I don't want to. So when I say reform, I mean I want the abolition, and perhaps to get the reform, you have to demand for the abolition. But be prepared, politically, that you may not get the abolition. Remember, the question was about 2016. Do you think we're going to abolish the prison industrial complex in 2016?
No.
So then the struggle for us is, this is politics, this is tactics. So let me remove my professorial hat, if I ever had it. Honestly, do we believe that we will be able to organize the revolution that we need to get the abolition of the prison industrial complex in 2016? I think that is not the case. But we have to do what your professor has been doing for a while. We have to begin shaking trees, and I'm glad that in this university people are talking about abolition. And I'm very happy. I was talking to my wife this morning saying, baby, we should move to Massachusetts Dartmouth. People here are for real. But I live on the other side of the street, and guess what? No one is talking about abolitionism in Duke University, Harvard, Princeton, etc. And this sounds elitist, but let me tell you how it happens. At least in terms of the knowledge production industry, in the short term, the elitist people have the upper hand. The salvation is that we are, by definition, smaller, and we the people are more, and we may be able to force the conversation by any means necessary. That's what we need, the by any means necessary approach, but we're not there yet. So anyway, we can continue this in the Unity House with some food and love, and love. Love is good. Okay, one more question, I think, because I'm getting tired.
Okay, I'm just gonna
shoot
quickly, not take too much time, but ask. So this transition from Jim Crow racism into new racism, colorblind racism, when we talk about prisons, we want to be very careful what we mean by reform, because what's happened is the penitentiary has become a correctional facility, right? The prison guard, no, just the language in the face of this punishment, this injustice called justice, has transformed to allow for that expansion of punishment, because when you shield violence within rehabilitation, you allow for community policing, right, which goes beyond the police station. So I just want to make that point so that we don't mistake what it means to promote prison reform. It doesn't mean that you're trying to make something that is violent look good. Or feel good.
And obviously that's not what I'm suggesting yet.
Right.
I didn't even give specific examples of what we should expect. Yeah, I even said most likely to get a reform, we need to ask for abolition. I'm talking 2016, so let me be very specific. So the issue for us is, if we're going to get any reform in this system that is about domination, about power, about social control, we also have to do the political, let's be honest, what is the political work that we need to do in terms of putting out, let me use a tactical language. In the 1970s, there was a Greek scholar, Nikos Poulantzas, who talked about non-reformist reforms. Reforms that after enacted are so disruptive that they force a break in a system. That's the kind of reform we have to imagine. If we're not going to get the abolition of the prison industrial complex tomorrow, what kind of non-reformist reforms can we imagine, can we envision, that ultimately will produce the revolution that we need to change the entire order? So we keep talking about prisons. Prisons are just a segment of an entire system. And therefore, let's not separate the discussion about abolitionism from the discussion on our critique of capitalism, patriarchy, and the racialized social system, yeah? So we have to have this comprehensive, this is not complex, but it's the truth. If we want to live in a better society, we'll have to have this intersectional politics and approach. Hard stuff to even imagine, but we have to begin somewhere. The conversation may have begun today at the University of Massachusetts Dartmouth, and hopefully we don't stop it today. we continue thinking, okay, long-term goals, short-term strategies, yeah? Because I am telling you, social movements are one dictate. If you only tell people, give me life or give me death, you are not going to be able to mobilize a lot of people. You have to produce some victories, even if they are small. Even if they are not like, oh, you know, we didn't get everything, but at least we got English as a second language. Or we wanted to have a, so most universities in the country are HWCUs, historically white colleges and universities. Okay, so we don't have a true university, yeah? Multicultural, multiracial, etc. But because of our struggles in the past, we created offices dealing with diversity. We now have a vice provost for diversity, etc. We can have a debate about how progressive that reform is and whether or not it's a non-reformist reform. But we have to produce them long-term goals, small things. Yeah? If not, I can guarantee you, the older, I come from a nationalist background in my family, and basically it was give me all or give me nothing. And the group that my family used to sympathize, the Nacionalista movement, ended up having a party with like 10 people, okay? Because nobody could, you know, like, and everybody was, I feel you, this is so beautiful. But you know what, I need some food. And you guys are telling me that if you collaborate with the American regime, you are a traitor. And for them, collaboration is you work in Walgreens as collaboration, you are a sellout. What do you mean? I'm working. I need a job. I have kids. So yeah, but you need to work only with Puerto Ricans. I'm like, well, the owner is Puerto Rican. Yeah, but the store is called Walgreens. Get it? I think I tried to answer your question as best I could. Okay, one last, and then we go.
I wrote this down. So
you mentioned we are all Americans, and the ideology of racism to depart from one society, we need to acknowledge that premise. What are your thoughts on certain individuals needing specific identities in the sense of hyphenated racial identities? For example, Native Americans, African Americans. Do you feel these needs for labels in the form of identity based on names actually promote racism through the form of people being forced by political correctness to accept these implied social separations by naming it specifically instead of just using the term Americans?
Those labels that you call identity labels are not the product of people of color wanting to separate themselves from so-called mainstream America. America has been a racialized nation from the get-go, and the separation is already imposed on us. These are, if you wish, let me use technical jargon, sort of defensive labels. I want just to be able to say I'm an American. The country doesn't, you know, when I go out there in the streets and the police officer stops me and calls me, as I've been called, the N-word, I'm like, excuse me, sir. Well, do you think I'm just an American, like you and I are the same. And biologically speaking, the research on genetics shows that 99.9% of our DNA is the same. That won't work. So the identity politics that you label are the product of a nation that has been divided by race and by class. So would you contemplate that then also in terms of class? Are you going to tell workers, stop calling yourself workers, you're just American, and then tell you, yeah, but I don't make any money, and the rich people own? Or are you going to tell women, why do you call yourselves women? We're all Americans. So these so-called identity politics are the product of systems of race, class, gender domination, and the solution to what you call identity politics is eliminate the systems, plural, as well as the outcomes that create the divisions, and then we at some point down the road will be able to become all Americans. So I ultimately want that, yeah? I would like for, let me go to my terrain. I would like for race to become, in a YouTube utopian future, a benign category, where it's just like a cultural category. I'm Puerto Rican, I will always eat arroz con habichuelas, rice and beans, and mofongo. I hope you have mofongo. But I am unwilling to contemplate seriously the argument that to get to that benign deal, I have to stop fighting for equality. Let's struggle for equality. You and I should struggle for the equality game. And then I'm telling you, naturally, all the labels will sort of dissipate. Imagine for a second that we really live in a colorblind society. We do not, but imagine that. Let's do a thought experiment collectively. If we are colorblind, would we have predominantly white neighborhoods? Should not make any, or even black neighborhoods or Latino neighborhoods, because presumably we all have equal opportunity. So at some point then, rather than the divisions we have now, it would be like, you know, I like Larry better than Tyrone, because Tyrone is, you know Tyrone, they're crazy. I like Larry, yeah? And I like Samantha, he looking good, yeah? So even the love thing would be more random than it is today. Today we can almost predict patterns of racial interaction, on marriage, on housing, on all these things. So then the job for us is, if we want that colorblind dream, we have to work at it, rather than preach it as just ideology. So let's work to make sure that we live in a society where, for sure, color is not the determinant factor in your life chances. Unfortunately, in terms of wealth, income, labor, etc., 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 race is still one of the central factors, not the only one, yeah? So mind you that I also talk about class and gender. So when we talk about these hyphenated Americans, what about working class Americans? Are we going to tell workers of the world, you're not a worker, you're just an American? Women, don't call yourself women. You are just like men without, you know, that thing. And they're going to tell you, hey, you're crazy. Women still make 77% of as much as men, controlling for all characteristics. Women still experience violence at a much higher rate than men based on a patriarchal organization. So to get to the promised land where race, class, and gender are no longer factors shaping our life chances, we have to struggle to remove the systems that produce the inequalities and therefore the labels. The labels are the expression of the inequality rather than the cause of the inequality. But I thank you for your question. Okay, thank you.